brothers and sisters of Hyderabad. At the outset, let me thank Maharajji for inviting me to this wonderful gathering of wonderful minds to share my thoughts with you, humble thoughts with you, on the very difficult subject of science and religion. Both are misunderstood very badly. Actually, I had delivered a lecture on the same subject about 5 years ago in Nagpur, which was recorded and it's on the YouTube, I am told. And someone in America has sent me a very nice certificate this morning. He said, "You are an idiot. Religion is bullshit and science you have not understood." I'm a scientist, he says. You know, this is the arrogance that comes from what's called a closed mind. When once you have an open mind, where is the mind incidentally? Never mind. And what is matter? No matter. But let me tell you something. Unlike what most of us think, the mind is not in the brain. Mind cannot be in the brain, because brain is too small an organ to hold this called mind. It's such an enormous thing. It's the canvas on which our thoughts are projected, and that's called consciousness. Gochara, have you heard of gochara? Sanskrit is a very beautiful language. Gochara means the path on which the cows walk. Gochara. And it also says gochara is awareness, consciousness, you know, the real thing. So where is the mind? Mind is everywhere. There's a universal mind which connects all of us, and there's an individual mind which is a part of the universal mind. And the man who said mind is in the brain and got the Nobel Prize himself, he was a Canadian neurosurgeon called Wilder Penfield. In the 40s, 50s, he started operating on awake patients, you know, after head injury. Many times, you know, younger generation doesn't realize, we tell them to put on the helmet. They don't. Do you know why we insist on that? If your head breaks, no doctor can do anything except God. That is why he says, Sharire jarjari bhute vyadhigraste vaidyo narayano hari. So, vaidyo narayano hari doesn't mean that doctors are all gods. It said, if you are very badly injured, very badly ill, the only doctor is God. And the only medicine is Gangajal. Which is true. But this man told me that I am an idiot. I said, fine. Then he said, you have not understood anything. And I hate you because you said in your speech that Ayurveda is science. Ayurveda is hocus pocus, bogus, pseudoscience. And I like the way he wrote. So venomous he was. You know, this is what happens, and I always have a different interpretation of yoga than what Swamiji said. There will be a lot of us do yoga. In the morning we sit and say om, 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 and then go on for about half an hour. And then for the next 23 and a half hours, we say how to destroy others, how to cheat others, how to make money and survive in this world. That is not yoga. Yoga is, you must live yourself in that. Chitta vritti nirodha yoga. You must get your mind away from all the vrittis, undulations, desires, the greed, the Wall Street greed today. Only I must make money, rest of them must be destroyed. That's the kind of thing, you know, this is called hatred or hostility. And that is what eventually kills you. But I did some work on this. I wrote about it some years ago. Then I did some work. I studied some people who made hating as their main purpose. They have to make somebody unhappy, otherwise they won't get sleep at night. And these people also thrive. Now I come to the conclusion that no two human beings are alike anyway. No two human beings are alike, so you can't have one policy for everybody. Some people, you know, they hate and then thrive on that. But by and large, hatred kills. Now coming to science, what is science? Lot of students are here. Let me see. What is science? Any answers? Any takers? No. What is science? Yes? Trying to understand nature. Yes. Science is curiosity, curiosity, you know, simple curiosity. What is curiosity? I just want to know. I just want to know, why does the sun set? Why does the sun rise? But we miss in this big bargain of questioning the essence of the sunrise. You know the sunrise message? There's a beautiful saying in my language, Kannada, which writes like Telugu, but is different. Yeruvanu. Yeruvanu is rising. Ravi sun. Kattaladane jagaladuvanu, fights with darkness and comes up. Yeridantele chikkavanagi toruvanu. That is, as he goes up, he looks smaller and smaller and smaller. You see, he's so big in the morning. If you've seen sun, if you've got up before sunrise, which rarely people do. Then if you observe the sun, he becomes smaller and smaller as he goes up. Yeridavanu, one who goes up, chikkavanagirabekele, must be humbler and humbler and smaller, is the message he gives to the world. That as you go up the ladder, you must be humbler and humbler and humbler. Vidya dadati vinayaha. What is education? It's not PhD or MD, BSc, ABCD, no. Humility. When I see a humble human being with humility, I salute him. He may be my peon, but if he is humble, he is educated. And an educated PhD, double PhD, who is arrogant, like the one who wrote me a letter in the morning, I don't respect him because he has not understood that. Today's education is just giving you a job. Education is aimed at making a wealthy career. No. In my opinion, education must aim at making a healthy mind. What is a healthy mind by definition? Mind filled with enthusiasm to work. Enthusiasm to work. Enthusiasm is a beautiful word if you understand Latin. En means inside. Theos means God. God sits inside and provokes you in the morning. That's what you say in the morning. Prachodayat. After Om Bhurbhuvah Swaha and all, ultimately what you say, Prachodayat, provoke me to do that. So enthusiasm to work. So morning you get up and say, I must go to work. Even if it's Sunday, doesn't matter. I'm not going to work for salary. I'm going to work because I love my work. If you love your work, you can work 24 hours of the day. You don't require even sleep. But when you hate your work, your 1 hour looks like a very long way. People complain about 8 hours work, 6 hours work, 7 hours work. The people who love their work, work for 24 hours. Swami Vivekananda worked for 24 hours. Ramakrishna Ji worked for 24 hours. They never complain. They never get burnt out. Burnout comes only when you work against your wish. When you don't love your work, you burn out. And that's why she says, I'm tired. I want a holiday. I must go to this place. I must go have a holiday. Look at all the presidents and heads of departments in the West. They all want to go for a holiday. Now we have a prime minister who has never gone for a holiday, even one day. He works. Now he has made the plane his room and works from, as soon as the plane lands somewhere, he gets up and gets ready to go to work and comes back to the plane and sleeps. That is the difference between loving your work and working your love. That's the difference. Anyway, an enthusiasm to be compassionate. Remember that if I want to be healthy, happy today, I can't go in search of happiness because happiness is not a goal. If I want to be, one certain way of becoming happier is making someone else happy. You see that someone else becomes happy, you become automatically happier. So give happiness. And that's exactly what is called compassion. Compassion is a beautiful word. You love everybody in this world, you become a compassionate human being. And then you become really a healthy mind person. And that must be the aim of education. Today, what's education? Tell me. We send our students to school, college, they get degrees. But when they come out, they work like ruffians on the road. They behave like ruffians. They don't have respect for others. They don't have social consciousness. I go for a walk in the morning. Of course, nowadays I can't go very easily because I had a minor stroke 6 months ago. Before that, I used to go for 1 hour walk. And I follow a particular route. And I see every day, every woman cleans her house and the water comes to the road. The dirty water comes to the road, so the water is fully dirty. The whole road is full of dirty water. It looks as if it has rained, but it has not rained. Their dirty water has come in. All that they want is, my house must be clean. The dirt can go elsewhere. They bring their dirt and put it in front of your house. I have seen people who don't like human beings, but they love animals. They have a dog. They take it in the morning and make it sit in front of a neighbor's house. One day I told a young lady who's supposed to be a student, one hand, what's that called? Smartphone. Anyway, I don't know what it means. In the other hand, the dog. She walks, every day she walks. And she brought the dog in front of my house as I was coming in. The dog shit there, big heap. Then I told her, young lady, see, I have to live here. So why do you want to? Only I am doing, huh? That's the answer of an educated person. That means if you catch somebody thieving your money, then you say, why do you want to thieve? Am I only thieving? That's the case. This is education, unfortunate. No, that's not education. Education is making a healthy mind. Let us aim at making a healthy mind of education. I tell you, this country, this world will change. Whole country will change. World will change because we live for others. Do you know why? You are not I, B.M. Hegde. That's what that lady was going to read, some bullshit. All that, you know, things. No, I am not I. I always tell people, I means illness. I am we. We means wellness. I was a cell the day I was made in my mother's womb. One cell, one single human cell called the zygote. That cell divided and divided and divided, but not completely. It still got attached to the other cell. You know, this is what's called a syncytium in Latin, which means cells without complete division. So I am now a colony of 120 trillion human cells. Individually, they are all human beings. And they are together. And with the biophoton camera now, I can take a photograph of yours and say how your cells are, how happy they are. They're jumping about, dancing. They love one another so much. And not only love themselves, they love the neighbor's cells. Supposing I sit with Swamiji for an hour or so, as Maharaj said here, that if you, for 1 hour, you think you are Ramakrishna, you will become Ramakrishna. If I sit for 1 hour with the Ramakrishna devotee, I get all the good cells influence on my cells. I become a Ramakrishna. I don't have to meditate. Now they love one another. So now what happens? Sometimes we start hating others. And our cells get confused. Why is he hating? I love the cells of the other person. Why is he hating? Then still we don't get the message. We still hate and go on. Then after some time, our own cells start hating our own cells. This is what is called in our language, the Western language, autoimmune disease. A disease which your own body cells kill your other body cells. We don't know what is autoimmune disease. If you ask a doctor, he says it's idiopathic. Idiopathic means I'm idiotic. I don't know what it is. But the real reason is I hate others. I make a lot of these people love others and the autoimmune disease regresses. There was a man called Norman Cousins who had an autoimmune disease called, it's a very bad disease like rheumatoid arthritis. Ankylosing spondylitis is the disease. Not even one muscle in his body moved. And he went to Harvard here, there, and he was a big American journalist. Norman Cousins, you must have heard. Then in Harvard, they said, you're going to die anyway, so we'll give you a free room, be there, enjoy, and then die. One day his friend came and cracked a joke. You know, they were all happy. They all laughed. He also laughed. Laughed. He saw his fingers moving. Then his friends went and brought all the jovial movies, you know, Charlie Chaplin in the old days. There were no televisions those days. They brought that 16mm reel in his room, fixed it, and he went on laughing the whole day. And would you believe he went out to the hospital 6 months later, completely cured, lived for another 60 years. He has written a book for you all. It's called Anatomy of an Illness. Anatomy of an Illness is a small book. Very small amount. Please read that. You will know how disease can be cured with your own mind. Because when you are sent here by God, he didn't think that there will be foolish doctors like B.M. Hegde to give you medicine. He said, no, there must be a doctor inside. He gave a doctor inside. It's called the immune system, which is the one that keeps you alive. And that's the one that cures you when you get a disease, not me or the surgery that we do. Actually, now recent studies have shown even bypass surgery is only a placebo. You know, one of my former teachers in Harvard, he's a Nobel laureate, Bernard Lown, he did a study. 600 patients were sent for bypass surgery at Harvard. He had a team of researchers, and they found none of them needed scientifically bypass surgery, because bypass surgery is not needed. So he said, okay, let us take advantage of this. Anyway, they have come, they have paid their money. So he had two theaters, theater A, theater B. Those days we could do it with the laser tip. You don't have to cut this chest and all. So he said, theater A, anesthetize, operate, send. Theater B, anesthetize, keep him sleeping there. When he wakes up, tell him he had a wonderful operation, send. So 300 patients here, 300 patients there. Now after 5 years, the audit showed the other who went to theater B, they're all fine. And scanning showed their muscles are normal now. Theater A, half of them did not get relief from their pain, so they had to have a cut open, big surgery. The other half are with their maker in heaven. The remaining half, that's one quarter, are having side effects of drugs, because I just now saw one person, one of the devotees of Ramakrishna Math. He's having all the horrible side effects of drugs after he had what he calls a stent, which I call a stunt. So this is what happens. So what is happening is, the mind is pleased. Okay, I am operated now, I am all right. That's enough. Then you may say, how do people with the, after operation get benefit? After paying 10 lakhs, doesn't your mind tell you, I am all right now? That's what happens. Now, what about drugs? You may say, oh, no, I am getting drugs. And they did a study in Harvard, Cambridge, Munich, and one other university. They did a study, what's called a crossover study. They took patients with severe pain the like of which patients had never experienced, and gave them a drip of morphine, which is supposed to be the best drug for pain killing. But while giving, the doctor in whom the patient had faith told the patient, this is not morphine. This is a vitamin we are giving to you, which is good for your health, but not for pain. Nobody's pain got relieved. With the morphine running in the vein, pain didn't get relieved. Then they took the patient over to, as I said, crossover study. They started saline drip, salt water, and told the patient, this is the best salt of morphine. Your pain will disappear like that, and pain disappeared like that. So everybody was surprised. What is happening? The researchers themselves were surprised. What's happening? So they said, okay, let us find out what the brain is doing, because brain has a memory power. Mind is not in the brain, but the memory is in the brain, in a place called hippocampus major. I still remember, in Tamil Nadu and all, if you go to the temple, especially Ganesha temple, you do what's called Topukarnam. You hold like this and... Terima? Tamil Nadu? Yes, when you do that, you pull your pinna down, you see. And when you pull your pinna down, it stimulates your hippocampus major. So makes your memory power go up. So children before the exam were sent to the Pillayar temple, to Topukarnam. See, our ancestors knew more science than what we know. Before knowing where the hippocampus major is, they knew that if you stimulate your ears, your hippocampus major gets stimulated. How did our school teachers in our days? They used to squeeze our... If you do a mistake, they squeeze it. That makes you a better student. So, see, this is how the ancient wisdom is much more powerful than the modern Western science. Now, the science that you are talking about in the West is not curiosity. There is anything but curiosity in that. That has become a religion, a bigger religion than all the religions put together. It has become so dogmatic that it says it shall be like this, it shall be like this. A paper should be written like this, and it should be peer-reviewed, and then only it's published, then it's called science, then we'll give you grant, etc. Today, scientist means write a paper, get it published, pat somebody's back, and then you get the grant money, get more money, and the bigger the grant you get, the bigger the scientist you are, which means a scientist today is a rich man. So who gets a lot of money, he becomes a big scientist. One who doesn't get grants doesn't become scientist. But really, knowledge advances not by repeating what is known and repeating the same thing, but by refuting what is dogmatic. Karl Popper said, science, knowledge advances not by repeating known things, but by refuting false dogmas. There are a lot of things, unknown things in this world. As a matter of fact, one of our scientists, who is a great scientist, who was a great scientist in America, he died recently. He's a Bengali. Rustum Roy was his name. You may wonder why Rustum is not a Bengali name. No. Rustum was the name of a friend of his father. And because the friend died young, he named his son as Rustum. Roy, of course, is Roy is a Bengali name. Rustum Roy is the greatest scientist that, in my opinion, in America. He went to America at the age of 17 and then became a professor of metallurgy in Penn State University and retired at the age of 80. Still, they said, you are our professor, till he died, because he was such a brilliant chap. He showed, he was reading a small stanza in the Rig Veda called Urj, which said, the mother and father of all thing energy is water. And then he found out the structure of water. And he found out how water has a very complicated structure. It's not H2O. It's a very complicated structure with a lot of loose bonds. And he was the one who found out that you can put a silver into the water, nanoparticles. It gets amalgamated into silver water, which is a very good antiseptic, antibiotic, very good for treatment. Actually, he was a PhD in metallurgy, but became professor of medicine in a big university in America, because he found out so many things about medicine from his ideas. And he was the one who showed that you can actually get energy from water. And you can, you know, really analyze water. He found out how to get atomic hydrogen from water. In our laboratory, you can get molecular hydrogen from water. What you leave behind is nascent oxygen. So if you put that for running an engine, the engine will be eaten up in 1 week. But Rustum Roy found out how to get atomic oxygen from water, and by passing radio waves through water. So he kept water in a test tube and passed radio waves, and out came atomic hydrogen. So he lit it. So he shows water burning. So he showed that Urj Sloka in the Rig Veda is absolutely right. But he didn't get his Nobel Prize. 21 times Nobel nominated, but didn't get the Nobel Prize, because each paper he wrote, he used to praise India. If you praise India, you will not get Nobel Prize. I want you to read a paper of Rustum Roy, which is in the internet free, called Matter is Not Made Out of Matter. What's the paper's name? Matter is Not Made Out of Matter. Very interestingly, he was talking about in a meeting where I was present, so he said, I'm a nuclear scientist. My job is to look at matter at its subtlest level and subtlest level. So I was doing it for 55 years. I started with Einstein, Niels Bohr, Werner Heisenberg, and then now I am the director of Max Planck Institute. But I found out in between somewhere there is no matter at all. And matter is not there, matter is just energy. So E is equal to M. He is the one who found out E, energy, is equal to matter, M. And he said, I call it as a duality. And he said, what am I in front of the Indian sages of yore, who had realized this long back as Advaita? A duality is called Advaita. He says in one stanza in the Upanishad, which has come to Bhagavad Gita and out, they have described the whole of quantum physics, because he's the father of quantum physics. His name is Hans Peter Dürer, H-A-N-S-P-E-T-E-R-D-U-R-R. And Hans, a good friend of mine, found out that one stanza, and he quotes that stanza in English in that. He says, Bahir Antascha Bhutanam, it is inside and outside of everything. What is that? Energy. Charam acharamevacha, it's moving all the time but looks solid. Now you all look solid, I look solid, but there's nothing solid about us. We are all just a bundle of jumping leptoquarks or electrons. Nobody has seen an electron. Sukshmavatet avijnayam. The sloka says, you can't see it. Just can't see it. Can you imagine that? Long, long ago, long before electrons were known. But even today, no scientist has seen an electron. But they've all got a Nobel Prize for describing what an electron is. Imagination only. J.J. Thomson in 1907 got the Nobel Prize for saying that electrons are particles. He was the director of the Cavendish Institute in Cambridge. 30 years later, his own son, P.J. Thomson, said they are waves. He also got the Nobel Prize. In 1925, Werner Heisenberg said uncertainty principle. He's absolutely right. He got the Nobel Prize. In 32, Schrodinger said they are wavicles. They are waves and particles. He also got the Nobel Prize. But nobody has seen the electron in the bargain. Why can't you see an electron? All great students in the back. Why can't you see an electron? Have you seen God? So God doesn't exist, right? Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So God doesn't have any evidence to exist, so he doesn't exist. That's not correct. That's called foolish science. That's called illogical science. Science has no logic. Illogical science. You know why? Why can't you see an electron? Huh? Again, the Upanishad says, Asino Vrajati Duram, Shayano Jati Sarvatha. When you sit, you are everywhere, and when you nowhere, you are nowhere. So beautiful, but you can't see an electron. Have you seen wind? An American poet has so beautifully described that. Who has seen the wind? Neither you nor I. But when the trees bend and dance, the wind is passing by. So I change that. Who has seen God? Neither you nor I. But when we are in trouble and shout for God, we feel God. Physics-wise, we can't see an electron because how do I see you physics-wise? A few photons in you should leave your body and come and hit my eye. Then only I am aware of your presence. You are there or not there, I don't know. That's Maya. That's why it's called illusion, uncertainty principle, illusion. But if one photon leaves an electron, it no longer is an electron. So how can you see an electron? You can't see an electron. So just because you have not seen God, it doesn't mean God doesn't exist. I don't know, I heard this in school. When Vivekananda was a little arrogant, young he was, he went to Ramakrishna and said, have you seen God? And what Ramakrishna did was, gave him a real hit on the face. Then he realized and went. So this is where what happens, you see. When you realize, go above, you can feel God. So Ramakrishna Paramahamsa felt God. And he felt God in everything that he said. And that's what inspired Vivekananda to follow him. Because Vivekananda was a rationalist. He wouldn't follow anything which he doesn't rationalize. So that's how Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was the greatest sage that I have ever seen, ever heard of, or ever read about. And Vivekananda was the most faithful shishya that I would like to be of any master. And the man who revived our ancient wisdom in the West. The next man after that who proved in science that Eastern science is greater than the Western science was Rustum Roy. And Rustum Roy is a great man. So he was saying in the meeting that I have not seen an electron, but I can feel an electron. And because I am a Western scientist, I know the hollowness of the Western science. You know, outside people don't know. If you want to know what science, Western science is, read this book, write down. It's called The Golem. Golem, G-O-L-E-M. G for God, O for Orange, L for London, E for England, M for Mother, Golem. Do you know what Golem is? Any Malayalis here? Golem, what is Golem? Any Malayalis here? Nobody from Kerala? Huh? In the Golem and then the. Golem. Scarecrow. You know scarecrow? Have you heard of scarecrow? The figure they put in a building and all. So science is created as a scarecrow to frighten the colonies, to keep them under their thumb. So today you see, the minute the Americans say it's science, you believe it. Otherwise you say Ayurveda is not science, you don't believe it. Because Americans don't think Ayurveda is science, so they say it's not science. So what is science? Golem. And science has become a greater religion than all the religions put together. Read this book. Science Set Free. The book's name is Science Set Free. Written by one of the greatest scientists the world has seen. Another greatest scientist. His name is Rupert Sheldrake in Cambridge. Rupert Sheldrake. You know Sheldrake? A biologist. Science Set Free. He says, science is under clutches. Set it free. Then only you can progress. You're not progressing now because science has become a more dogmatic religion than religion. So, That is how, what is religion? Religion, what does it mean? Join again, you're taking you back to your roots with probably, as some people said, yoga is connecting Atman with Paramatman, which it is not. Patanjali never said, actually there is a view, I don't know how far it's true, that Patanjali was an atheist, he never believed in God. That's why Patanjali said, simply you become God. Chitta vritti nirodha yogaha. You become a yogi when you don't have any nirodha in your chitta, in your mind. Chitta is a different level of mind. See, mind has five levels according to Ayurveda. Manas, child's mind, which is like a dark room and an opening. Child sits inside. And anybody passes that side, child smiles. You know how many times a child smiles in a day? 500 to 1,000 times. Count how many times you have smiled yesterday. Some of us don't smile at all. We are so grim. We did some study on what's called a healthy heart, heart rate variability. In a child's heart, it is so good that the child breathes in, the heart goes fast. Child breathes out, heart goes slow. It's called heart rate variability, HRV. We studied that in patients full of hatred for others after heart disease and all. They have hardly any heart rate variability. We gave them yoga training, made them human beings. They came back to the child's heart. So I always tell my students, keep a child's heart in you. You will never die. You will never age. Never become big. Now look at this child smiling at everybody. That's called manas. Then you send the child to school. Alexis Carrel, a Nobel laureate surgeon, wrote, every newborn child is a genius, only to be converted into an idiot in school. No, in school you want everybody to be same, you know, because that's the Industrial Revolution time in England. You wanted simply unquestioning, unthinking people to work in the factory. Suppose they question, they say, why am I working on this machine? Then you are in trouble. So he should simply work, because you tell him to work, he works. Teach him to work, he works. That's the education system. That's we inherited from the British. And we left our education system of what is called the real yogic system, where upa, ni, shad. Upa is close, ni is the vacuum you take, shad is sit. So sit down by the side of your teacher with that vacuum, the anxiety, the appetite to learn, and you learn from him, sitting very close to him. That has gone. Gurukula system, which was where the student really follows the footsteps of the teacher. You know how this, how Vivekananda sits by the feet of Ramakrishna and just absorbs Ramakrishna's thinking and thoughts and makes it his part of his life. That is a real education. Here it's not like that. In school, we want everybody to be alike. You can never make two human beings alike. There are no two human beings are alike in any way. That's why I said some people hate and then still thrive and live long. Some people hate and die. So, children, now what is happening in the school now? A for everybody child should say apple. B for bat. C for cat. Now this is the wrong education. If you ask a child, two children, A for what? One will say something else. One will say something else. Their own ideas of the world. But in the school you make them robots. Identical. Everybody is the same. So what happens to this thing when you go to school? You are told something which you inherit, you put into your head, it's called buddhi. So the next level of mind is called buddhi. So you make the child an idiot, it becomes buddhi. Then there is another level, the third level is called chitta, above the buddhi, where aham comes in. Like for example, this child sitting there, Swamiji passes there, smiles. B.M Hegde passes there, it says, that rascal B.M Hegde I don't like. Now, that is because buddhi tells B.M. Hegde is a bad man, Swamiji is a good man. So, that chitta is a level where you start hating. That's why Patanjali said chitta, that level, vritti, that hatred, nirodh. Don't put government nirodh, it leaks. So, put the yogic nirodh so it doesn't leak. So, chitta vritti nirodha yogaha. So, what's the next level? Viveka. So people say, okay, you don't like B.M. Hegde, forget it, let him go to dogs. What are you worried about? Why are you spoiling your peace of mind? That's the level, it's okay. Most of us come to that level sometimes. But that's not enough, because you should not have that attitude at all. Purusha, the next level is called Purusha. From the Purusha, if you go up, further up, Purusha Shrestha Ishvara, you become really God. Ishvara is not God. Ishvara is one who is Sthita Prajna, one who is one with the surroundings. So if you see B.M. Hegde going there, you must say, okay, he has come from Mangalore, poor fellow. It's already 2 o'clock. Whether he's had lunch or not, I don't know. So let me call him inside. You call him inside your house, give him a warm meal, make him comfortable. That's called the Ishvara level. You are absolutely Sthita Prajna. And that's exactly what you should become. You are a yogi. So this is how you elevate your mind from manas to Ishvara. And that's how yoga teaches you how to, what Swamiji was now telling about how the mind can be changed by yoga. That's exactly what it is all about. So it's not about God. So God is a concept. God, all of us have gods in us. Swami Vivekananda says, believe in your divinity. And if you think you are God, you never do bad things, ungodly things. You only do godly things. And what is godly things? God loves everyone. God doesn't make a distinction between B.M. Hegde and Swamiji. For him, both are same. Both are his children. So same level we must reach, the godly level. And that's what yoga teaches us. And that's what the ancient wisdom teaches us. That's what the modern science should teach us. So we don't want this science, which is a golem, and science which is a very tight, controlled business. It's an establishment. And one of the greatest scientists who got the Nobel Prize wrote a book called Limits of Science. And he wrote, his name is Peter Medawar. And Peter writes, science is an establishment, an enterprise, built for answering certain simple questions. And you can't ask esoteric questions to science. Like, for example, you ask science, how did you come to this world? Science won't answer. It's like asking a train which is bent to run on a rail to fly. So science cannot answer important things, but religion can. Religion is what's called spirituality. What is spirituality? This is a great term which our ancestors thought of. Our ancestors were not foolish as we think they were. They saw one important thing in their, around their life. An animal is alive, it breathes. When the animal is dead, it stops breathing. So they thought breath is God. Breath is called spirits, spirus in Latin. Spirit, not spirits. Spirits are the ones available in wine shop. Spirit is spirus, breath. So they said, breath is something which enters you, which God enters you when you are born, and leaves you when you are dead. That's how the whole thing, spirituality, started, and that's where the spirituality evolved into a thing, and which religions, of course, put around them. Even religions are establishments, I'll tell you. Some of the religions, organized religions, are biggest money spinners in this world. You probably don't know. I don't know if you know. Some of them are biggest money spinners. So it's for making money and fooling people, we call it as religion. That's not the idea. Religion is to make you a human being from an animal that you were when you were born. And that's called really spirituality. And that's the idea which is very, very relevant today also, because we all should go that path. And not that we should become a religious person, but tells us we must have a religious bent of mind, which says all of us are same, all of us are children of God, and as I told you scientifically, all of us have the same cells, and we love one another. So trying to help others is not doing any service to them, it's service to you, because when you try to help somebody, your cells become happier, you become healthier. So isn't it a good idea to help somebody? So if you know that, won't you help someone? So you help someone because you know when you help someone, you improve. So with the selfish idea also, you try to help someone. That is why our ancestors said, paropakarartham idam shariram. This body is meant for only others' benefit. It's absolutely true. But we just ignore it. And we say, well, why should I help somebody? It's not my job. I'm not paid for it. A lot of people say, I'm not paid for it. I always tell my students, each one at least reach one. Because, you know, you are here not just to make money and look after your wife and children or husband and wife, which even a dog does. as a human being, you must look after the whole community, whole world. And that is your, that's where you are here for, and aim at that and become a good human being and thereby become a good citizen of the world. In short, we are all same, you know, we, this caste, creed, religion, race, color, all these are artificial, man-made. We are all Vasudhai Eva Kutubakam. We are one family, one large family in this world. So I always call myself a citizen of the world. A lot of people call me and say, oh, you are having your research center in Tamil Nadu, it seems. But we must have in Karnataka. Aren't you from Karnataka? I said, no, I'm not from Karnataka. I'm from India. I'm from the world. So if you don't like my research center in Chennai, because I was a student in Chennai, when I was a student, I was a part of Tamil Nadu. And when I was in the middle of my MBBS course, I became a non-Tamilian. They threw me out. Did not even give me pay as a house surgeon. But I survived. But I still love that place because that's my origin. And I still continue there. And I can read and write Tamil because we had, when I was a student, Rajagopalachari was a chief minister. So he said, learn the language of your place. So we learned Tamil. We learned read and write Tamil, and I used to read Ananda Vigadan Kalki and all. Of course, now more than half a century, I take a lot of time to read because I have to analyze every letter. But that is how we grew. And I still have my research center in Chennai where I see patients. And I don't see patients in Mangalore where I live. I live for my life there, and I do the research and seeing patients in Chennai where I work with my friends, who have been my friends for the last more than half a century. So this is how life goes on. So friends, religion and science are the same, two faces of the same coin. Both are enterprises, both are business. Science is a big business, religion is another big business. But not Sanatana Dharma, which is not for any making money or doing that. The real Sanatana Dharma, which Ramakrishna proclaimed, which Vivekananda spread to the world, is a real Dharma. The man's philosophy, man's life, man's existence on this planet. Paropakarartham idam shariram. So don't get excited when somebody says it's science. I'll tell you something. I've been saying that coconut oil is the best oil for human consumption, and it's very good for the heart. I have given a lecture in the American College of Cardiology in Boston also. People wanted to kill me. In the older days, they used to put you in the mental hospital if you said something against the conventional thinking. You know, there was a time when there was a man called Simmelweis in Europe who found out one thing. Whenever doctors went to deliver a woman, that woman died of a puerperal sepsis. She got some fever after delivery. She died. And he observed all that, kept records and statistics. Then he found one day his own anatomy professor who was teaching him, one day dropped his scalpel on his own finger. He developed the same disease. So he hypothesized that the poison from the dead body is the one that gives you the disease. So what doctors used to do is they dissect dead body in the morning and come to the ward and deliver women. But midwives who never went to the dead body thing, they had 90% successful rate. So he wrote all that and told the world, you doctors should wash your hands after your thing in carbolic soap and then go and deliver, nothing will happen. Then people said, he's a madman, washing hands. What does he mean? He is mad. So they made him mad. And collectively they put him in a mental hospital. And he died in the mental hospital. But later on they found out he was right. Washing hands, doctors washing hands has saved millions of lives, which he proclaimed those days. These people didn't take it. Anyway, this is what about the coconut oil. The mice theory was very simple. Coconut oil and mother's milk have the same fatty acid, which is called monolauric acid, monolauric acid is the base of a human immune system. That's why mother's milk you take for 6 months, you have no illness. You don't require vaccination. That's the best vaccination that you can have. Mother's milk you drink for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, you don't need vaccination at all because it gives you full vaccination. And then mother's milk, if it is that good, coconut oil must be equally good. People said he's mad, oh, they abused me, they are all kinds of rubbish. Then suddenly America realized after about 40 years that coconut oil is the best oil. And America started proclaiming coconut oil is good. Then they say, yes, B.M Hegde is after all not a foolish fellow. He's right. Because it has to come from America. We are so slavish, I tell you. Today, yoga has gone to America and is coming back slowly. You go to America, there are about 43 schools of yoga. Everybody has a yoga school. One day I went to a city, and there was one lady in the audience. She came and said, "Doctor, when I was a child, you treated me and saved my life. You must come to my house for food." I said, "All right." So somebody calls you for a free food, why not? So I went in the evening. After food, she said, "Doctor, my husband is an engineer. He works, I am running a school of yoga." I said, "What school?" Her name was something X, let us say, B.M Hegde scholar. B.M Yoga or something like that, after her name. "And I have written a book, you must write a foreword." I said, "Okay." She said, "What are you?" "I have written a book called Pranayama." "What's Pranayama?" "Pranayama." "Pranayama. Savarna Dirga Sandhi." I said, "Pranayama, my God, no. It's Ayama, Pranayama, movement of breath." And this is a kind of yoga that you have hot yoga, cold yoga, yoga at 70 degrees centigrade and all. It's all commercial. So they make and that yoga comes here, we say yes. Acupressure from India, especially from Siddha and Ayurveda. What's called in Siddha, they've got a wormology, you know, pressure points where you can stimulate, you can get diseases come under control. It went to China through the Chinese travelers and became acupuncture there. Came back, it can be practiced in New York because the government then after independence in 1948 supported that. Whereas our government in 1947 when we became independent, they condemned Ayurveda because we didn't have Indians as our rulers. We had RNIs, you know, resident non-Indians. As our rulers for 70 years. What they said was, Ayurveda is bad. Don't encourage Ayurveda. So you can't practice Ayurveda in New York legally. You can practice acupuncture in New York. But today Ayurveda has become so popular in the West, people don't know. This boy who wrote to me a letter this morning doesn't know. There are 70 places in Ayurveda centers in America. There are 4 Ayurvedic medical colleges in America. And there are a lot of practitioners of Ayurveda in America. And Ayurveda is accepted in the West as a science. And Ayurveda is a holistic science. It understands the body as a whole. Not only as a whole, it understands something more, that each body is different. You can't have one size fits all thing. That's what we do in modern medicine. If this pill works for you, it should work for all of them. And we have what's called evidence. What's the evidence? Controlled studies, cross-sectional studies. We collect about 100 people, give it to them and show that it works. But whereas we had observational research in the olden days, they saw something very interesting, observed. What they saw was those who were all, you know, in the mental hospital never got an illness. Did you know that? People were locked up in the olden days with mental disease inside the hospital, closed, locked for 40 years, 30 years, 50 years. And observation showed none of them had even common cold. So they wrote that, you know, there's no common cold for people who are in the mental hospital. So we only misinterpreted that. Passion makes some of the best observations but draws wretched conclusions. So we said, if you don't get cold, you'll go mad. So I remember when I was young as a doctor, a lot of people used to come and say, "Doctor, I didn't get a cold for 2 years. Make me have cold." I said, if I don't get a cold for 2 years, I'll pray God. Why? No, if you don't get cold, you'll go mad, I believe. So I want cold. This is the idea. But their observation was right. And similar observations were made. And what they had shown was very interesting finding. That is, when you are a schizophrenic, you have a split personality. You are not yourself. You don't know yourself. You don't know your body at all. You live in a different world altogether. And how can you get a disease? We get disease when you're worried about your body. You every day think, "Will I get cancer? Will I get cancer?" One day you will get cancer. So their observation was right. And they had seen over 40, 50 years how it works. That's how our drugs evolved. Today, America is learning that. What they are doing is they found out, they went to the Amazon forest. And in the Amazon forest, there are people like our ancestors, living for 40, 50 years without touch with this nature. They don't even have a piece of cloth on themselves. There's a group called Shimones. These are the aboriginals on the Brazilian border of Amazon forest. These people live up to 100 years. They procreate. They don't have any illness. If they have an illness, they know what herb to take. And this was studied by the drug company Bandicoots in America, and they have now said they have befriended the loggers in Amazon forest. They say, okay, how much money do you make by cutting the forest? So much. We'll give you more. Leave the forest alone because that's our future. All our gold mine is in the forest. And we will, so this is the research that's going on in the West now. So look at it. Our Ayurveda had herbs, actually nearly 1,500 herbs. And before that we had what's called folk medicine in India. Folk medicine was very powerful in India. People treated people with some knowledge. Even today they do, a lot of people do that. I hear sometimes people come and say, it seems there is a folk doctor in Shimoga who gives treatment for cancer. So I just wanted to find out. So I went to Shimoga all the way, took a taxi, paid 5,000 rupees and went there. And went to this man's house, an old man in the village. So I told him, you treat cancer? I believe, yes. I said, what's cancer? He said, I don't know. Then what's it? My father told me this herb will treat, I keep it there. I said, do you treat also cancer, kidney disease? Yes. Which one? Same herb. He doesn't know a damn about anything. But you know how the word spreads? One person came and told me, sir, sorry, kidney disease, you people don't have any medicine, you know, you dialyze. That man cured the Sultan of Oman of his kidney disease. He went there and gave the medicine. So when I went there and saw this, I was shocked how they survived. But it's faith that cures. Many times the faith fails to cure, you die. When you die, they don't record it. So unscientific. They don't record anything which is negative. They record everything that is positive. Somebody survives because he's lucky to survive. He's destined to survive. You don't die with any disease necessarily. So this is how this spreads. Anyway, but folk medicine survived for thousands of years in India. And from folk medicine, Ayurveda got a lot of drugs also. So Madhava Nidana and later on, you get drugs from folk medicine also. So a lot of drugs. Otherwise, Ayurveda's essence is Swastasya Swastha Rakshitam. That's the greatest philosophy in ancient Indian science, wisdom. That is, preserve the wellness of the healthy people, which is very, very easy. In this audience now, 99% will be healthy. If you can keep them healthy for another 10, 15 years, it's very lucrative. Supposing you have, say, you find about 4 people and say, I'll dialyze them. It's very expensive and ultimately they'll die anyway. Dialysis is just prolonging their misery for some more time and making money at that. So today we have become making money at human misery. But Hippocrates, our father said, never make money in the sick room. But that's exactly what we do today. No? You go to the hospital, what will they do? You will come back with not only your disease half maintained, they don't cure it, they don't want to cure anything. I met a young man in Pune, MBBS. After that, he said, sir, I didn't want to study the rotten things written there. I know diabetes can be cured. He told me, diabetes can be cured. Did you hear that word? Mark my words, diabetes can be cured. So he started an organization called freedomfromdiabetes.org. His name is Pramod Tripathi, young man. He grew up in Pune, though he was a Tripathi from UP. And I went to see him. He had what's called Muktosava. People were cured of diabetes by his method. And how many people were there? 2,500. And he gave them all a certificate saying that you are cured of diabetes and no drug he uses, nothing. His diet, special diet, which his wife teaches you how to cook, and then his exercise. And now, after about 3 months of my going there and studying and sending patients there, who are all very happy, because the former Home Minister of India, Sushil Kumar Sinde, told me in that meeting, he had come there for a certificate. He said, doctor, with 80 units of insulin and 4 tablets a day, my sugar was 400, 300 and all. Now with this boy's treatment, without any drugs, without anything, I am 100, 150, 140. If any one of you have diabetes, write to him, freedomfromdiabetes.org, O-R-G. Get his number and call him. He's a very pleasant young man. Go there. He has got a resort. You can stay there for 1 week. He will teach you how to eat the food and how to exercise. And you come out without any diabetes. Western medicine says diabetes cannot be cured. It can be only controlled because you want permanent drugs to be sold. This is our... hypertension cannot be cured because you want to maintain it. So that's how things happen. I like people like Pramod. I love that boy. I want to hug him because he has done something phenomenal. He has thought out of the box. and thought what the dogma, he demolished the dogma. So he followed Karl Popper. Karl Popper is a great scientist who became a science philosopher and then ruled the London School of Economics like a colossus for 2 decades. And Popper was the one who thought of a lot of things and wrote about it. Greatest thinker. Pramod Tripathi is a very good thinker and he does a lot of good things. So instead of being slaves of the Western medicine, go to Pramod and get your diabetes cured, C-U-R-E-D in capital letters. So friends, religion and science are brothers. They are both having the same idea of fooling people and becoming the religion of the West. I'm talking of the organized religions of the West. But science is not something great. Don't get frightened. It's only a scarecrow. It frightens you to make you a bakra in their hands. So that you say, lot of people say, that diet is scientific. One day you say high fat diet is very good for, another day you say something else is there. Very interestingly, some American scientist did a study. He had devised some diets, and so diabetic diet, non-diabetic diet, etc. And put about 1,000 people on that and then studied. What he found was, people with diabetes, they did very well on a diet full of ice cream. And they did very badly on the diet which is no sweet at all. Because somebody was telling me, I had a diabetic patient. I've been observing him, because old man, he was about 85 and when I saw him. His sugar used to be 650, 700 and all. And he'll come, then I'll write prescription and tell him and scold him and say, you must do this. His children also will come with me. He'll say, yes doctor. Bend down. I'll do that doctor. Don't eat anything. He says, yes doctor. At home they restrict. If he goes for a marriage, all the payasam there is there, he'll eat all that. But one thing he did faithfully was walk about 15 miles every day. He'll get up from his house, walk to the railway station 5 miles, get onto the train, go to Mangalore, 15 minutes, and then get down from the train, walk to the bandar for making his business there, another 5 miles, and then come back and eat a huge meal, and then sleep, and go home, again another 10 miles. So, and that's that way he lived up to 90 years and died in sleep when he was 94. Nobody could have. Anayasena maranam. He died without knowing that he was going to die. Dina dhyayinena dhijivanam. He never begged for anything from anybody. He earned everything himself. He ate what he wanted to eat. He looked after his children. A real ideal man. But his sugar was always 650, my report. So don't get frightened. A lot of people send me reports. This is my report, doctor. Treat me. I tell them, I have not learned to treat reports. I have learned to treat human beings. These reports are all, see, I don't know. We learned medicine in a different way. We were taught that when you see a patient, examine him. Listen to him. Understand him. Examine him correctly. And come to a conclusion. Then if you want to confirm or reject, do a few tests. Today it's not like that. You go to a doctor, they won't even examine you. They'll immediately ask for a CAT scan, dog scan, PET scan. I'll tell you my own experience. 2 weeks ago, I had a driver. After the stroke, I had a driver. Young Muslim boy. Very nice boy. Very, very nice boy. And he had a motorbike. He'll come in the morning by the motorbike, drive my car till evening, and go back home. At evening when he was going, he met with an accident. And his patella was gone. Left leg patella was gone. Patella got cut off. So he went to an orthopedic doctor. He asked for an MRI, a CAT scan, and something else. So he did all that. And then he said, you require a major operation. For 2 weeks, I'll put you on a cast and then operate on you. Put him on a cast, ordinary cast. Then I had a doubt. Are you, what is this? Patella is gone. Why is he casting the joint and immobilizing the joint? So I told my physiotherapist, a young boy, I said, you know the muscles and joints correctly. I'll get my driver, examine him. So they got the driver home. I asked, did the doctor examine him? No. He said, the minute he saw me, he said, get an X-ray, get an MRI. This boy examined him carefully and said, sir, only his patella has gone. He doesn't need the patella. It's a left leg. And yours is an automatic car. He doesn't require the left leg to. But they are spoiling his joint now. That joint will have to be replaced after some time. They have fused the joint. So I'll undo the joint. He undid the joint and in my presence he said, now walk. He walked. Now he's back at work. He doesn't have to do anything. And nothing happened. No operation, nothing. He is fine. Back at work. But today, doctors don't examine patients. One very famous orthopedic surgeon in Chennai came to see me. He said, doctor, I want you to examine me. I have a lot of problems. This thick report from about a 5-star hospital. So I said, Dr. So-and-so, remove your shirt. I want to examine you. You want to examine me? I said, yes. No, all the reports are there. I said, reports for, I can't treat the reports. I will treat you, no? So he removed his shirt reluctantly and lied down on the table. I examined him for about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, carefully, and came to some conclusion and told him what. He said, no, I didn't know that. I was told this, X, Y, Z. I said, X, Y, Z is from the report, but this is what is examining you. And he's all right now. He had about 20 tablets. Now he doesn't take any tablet, he's fine. Now the other day, one of my students, senior students, who was in England, came here. So he met me in the airport. He said, sir, medicine has changed, sir. You are in the olden days. Nobody examines patients now because all the scans are there, we do that. But sir, the learned teaching I had as a student, even now I follow that, sir, to my benefit. Even in England, I practice what you teach. Like a third-year student, I examine a patient religiously, meticulously, as you're taught, and come to a conclusion, which most of the time I am right. This is true. I still remember the day when my consultant, was a senior, very senior consultant, big man, admitted a patient in the ward when I was a senior registrar as a patient with possible cancer in the lung because he had some fluid. Patient was I had to examine the patient in the morning. So I went there, examined the patient very carefully and found out that the patient had left heart failure. And that's why the little fluid in the lung. So I wrote there, this is an early left heart failure with some fluid. And I gave him a diuretic. By the time this consultant came for rounds the following day, the patient said, I am fine, doctor. Then he looked at that. See the greatness of people. He went to the patient and said, look, Mr. So-and-so, I was wrong in my diagnosis. This young doctor from India was right. And because of him, you are surviving, not because of me. Who will do that? Nobody will do that. That is the greatness. And I still remember that man because he is almost like God. I call him as T.A.W. Watkin Edwards. And a great man. And that was the kind of, you know, you examine a patient, you come to a conclusion, which is the best conclusion that you can get at. And that's what medicine is all about. So science in the West is not science, it's a business. Religion in the West is also a business. So both science and religion belong to the same category. So don't get enamored of a word science because it comes from America, it's scientific. He says, oh, this, you know, I saw some advertisement yesterday, as Swamiji was saying, I was looking at the television, said, one toothpaste came, what is that, Colgate Veda, or, he said, this is a combination of Vedic wisdom and the Western science, where the science of Colgate toothpaste is combined with all the Vedic wisdom from the East. I was laughing to myself, my God, what foolish ideas these people have got. And they think Vedic wisdom is just combining some herbs with the Colgate. Just to sell that. That's the idea. You know, have you seen that sensitive Colgate toothpaste? With a small clove picture there. Clove extract. My old granny used to say, when you have a toothache, put a clove there, it'll be all right. So this is how, you know, things change. And we are fooled. And we believe the West because for 300 years, we were their captive. And they fooled us and they brainwashed us. Now also we believe them. It has to come from them. There's an old saying in my language, Shankha Dinda Bandara Tirtha. It should come from the Shankha. If it comes from the well, it's not Tirtha. It has to come from the Shankha, it becomes Tirtha. No, Swamiji? So friends, what have we been saying for so long? You are confused now. Because I didn't have the slides, etc. I used to also carry those slides in the olden days. One day I was lecturing in IIT Bombay. At the end of the lecture, one professor got up and said, Professor, please don't bring those slides. We can't concentrate on what you are talking to. So you talk to us. You are better in conveying your ideas than using the slides. And slide for 2 seconds and slide passes off. And then you talk. We can't concentrate on two things at the same time. Please don't use your slides. And ever since that time, I have not used the slide. I got thousands of slides. I don't use them. In the class, I still believe in what is called chalk and talk. I take the chalk to the class and take the class, and my students like it. And I take a class in America, I take a class in England, I ask for a chalk and talk. I don't have slides there. Because I once went for a conference on education, and a lot of big, big professors were called to give talks. One lady was a big professor in Bombay came. She was a kidney specialist. So she was to give a talk. So she had slides. So she had slides one after another. From top to bottom, what was written in the textbook from left-hand side to the right-hand side. She will read that. For one long hour, all that I saw was her back. I didn't understand anything. If that is what she is talking to you, I can as well read the same book. Teaching must come from your experience, from your wisdom. You know what wisdom is? What's wisdom? Lot of people equate knowledge with wisdom. Knowledge dwells in heads replete with thoughts of other men. He said this, this book said that, that is it. Wisdom dwells in heads attentive to their own. Knowledge is so proud because it knows so much. I am a MD, PhD, ABCD. Wisdom knows no more. So humble because it knows no more. Knowledge and wisdom, far from being one, have nothing in common. There's a great thinker in the West called Goethe, von Johanna Goethe in Germany, who's a great man, who once said, I now know philosophy, physiology, jurisprudence, even alas, theology from end to end with labor skin. But here I stand, O fool, with all my lore, no wiser than before. Lot of people say, I am 40 years of teaching experience. You've been an ass of a teacher 40 years ago and you're the same ass today. Experience is a very simple word. In Sanskrit, there are two words, anubhava and anubhuti. Anubhava is my experience. Anubhuti is how I change with my experience. You know? I still have, every day you change. Now I have lectured to you. Now there are certain mistakes I have done. I must learn from that and never do the same mistake in the next lecture. That's why I like critics. That's why I always follow Churchill's fall for life. It says, he has a right to criticize who has a heart to help. He has no right to criticize if he is wanting to harm you. Supposing he wants to help you, he has a right to criticize. So learn from criticism first. And then go on and move on. It's called anubhuti. And I've got 50 years of anubhuti as a teacher. Fecund experience. That's called, in English, you can call it as fecund experience. And that's called wisdom. And wisdom, you know, I always tell my student, ask me a question in the class. Because a question comes from a new thought in your mind. And have that new thought, you progress. Now, answers can be foolish, but questions are profound. Ask a question, I always tell them. And I want a teacher to say in the class, open class, that I don't know the answer. That day he's a mature teacher. Because you should not give an impression to the students that I am a Mr. Know-all and you are nobody. They'll never progress. You say, I also came from your standards. I have improved. You also can improve. Then they say, okay, I will also be one day like him. So that is how a teacher should be. So anubhuti. Thank you all very much.